Lawrence Monoso, Judie Aronson, Carey, Camilla Moore. Big round of applause, Director Joe Zito.
Something bad comes out of the water usually.
characters are real in the script. It's funny, my friend went out for a minute and he hadn't seen the movie for a while, so he doesn't memorize it like us nerds. And he came back and he's like, oh, who died? I'm like, oh, nobody. He's like, well, everybody was cheering. I'm like, oh, that was everybody cheering for Crispin, you know, getting his compliment. And so, yeah, that's one thing, and it really, yeah, kind of clicked that. It's like, oh, this is one of the few movies in this series where the whole audience can applaud a moment that's not a death, because these characters, the guys you play, and all your other co-stars, they're really likable in this one, and they felt more real than most of the movies in the series. And so, good job on that, all of you.
Yeah, that's one thing I remember reading the review in the New York Times, and I remember the critic in the New York Times said that this Friday was the most offensive out of all the ones that they saw. And the reason they said that was because that they actually liked the cast, that the actors brought like real, there's real people, relationships, a little bit that's developed in this film, and so that when the killings happen, that it's all the more sort of jarring and disturbing because of the, you felt for the characters a little bit. So I remember that, yeah.
Yeah, we're not rooting for Jason in this one. We're rooting for
a little bit. Yeah.
We're rooting for everything. We don't want him to do nothing, because that would be a very boring movie. For Judy and Lawrence, you guys are part of the main group. Did you guys, how much of you did you know each other beforehand? Any of your co-stars? Did you get a chance to like kind of hang out and bond for a bit before filming?
Did I know you before? I feel like I didn't see you. No? No? Just mutual friends?
Yeah.
I knew.
I don't think any of us knew each other at the time, but definitely didn't know these two. And then I didn't know Crispin. I think I knew Barbara Howard.
I knew Peter. My very first acting job, I played Peter's girlfriend in a TV show.
Oh.
So Powers of Matthew Starr was a TV show I got my SAG card on. And I think it was a new girlfriend.
And for you guys, for you lovely ladies, do you know, was the costume designer on this film, did they ever work again? I know you're not thrilled about your wardrobe choices. Then Camilla, you, what happened?
that everything was set up. We didn't rehearse, and suddenly, and I, you know, actresses always think they're fat. I was already struggling with, I'm so fat, and suddenly this bed breaks. And I'm in there with Crispin, who's already stuttering because he's getting really, like, excited about the scene. And erotic, and I wasn't allowed to wear a top for it, so he told the whole crew, if she's not wearing a top, then I'll take my boxers off. And I was like, let me do it. Anyway, yeah. Was it set up?
No, it was not supposed to break.
You see, I was.
That's crazy.
Yeah. But you're known as the one who broke the bed with Crispin, so.
Yeah, exactly. That one.
You guys kind of got off easy when it comes to the death scenes, because you had stunts kind of doing the bulk of the work there. Did you do?
Not me.
Yeah. Oh, well, we'll get into that. That's the, we have a spectrum here. We have the easy and the worst. How much of your death scenes was actually? Did you get involved?
Well, I think that's one of the great things of actually seeing the movie for real at the end, because when you're actually doing the acting, you know, you're aware that you're doing a horror movie and you're aware that you're gonna die and whatever, but when you do have a stunt that basically does a death, I mean, I just had the, you know, the dance and the bit of the flirt and this and that, and then suddenly I'm going out in the rain and suddenly it's thunder and, you know, lightning, but I don't actually experience my own death, so it takes seeing it on the screen to really see how it all comes together, you know, because suddenly that was a complete stunt. So, you don't get the feeling of the whole movie. So for me, it was our first movie as well. So it, you're very green at that stage. I've never experienced a stunt person taking over, and I had to stick my head out of that window, and then he grabbed me, but then I had to hold back, and then the next time there was a stunt girl dressed up in exactly my outfits, and she bounced on a trampoline and went out of the window onto a mattress on the top of the car. And I was like watching from down below. I'm like seeing supposedly myself falling out of the window. It's just very surreal.
Well, she hit the car. She actually hits the car.
Well, she does. She
launches herself. Yeah.
But she landed on a mattress the first time, and then didn't she?
Hits the car.
She hits the car
hits
first?
The car, dents the roof, and then falls off onto a mattress.
Oh.
You did not get a stunt double. For those that don't listen to the commentaries and read the books and everything, how exactly was your death scene pulled off?
I'll finish there.
Okay, anyway, just so you can pay attention to the car, you can see that it was just two takes that the car was hit by that stunt woman. Twice.
Twice.
Went out the window, hit it, and they missed sinking the along the windows because those are done with explosives. So the windows are all rigged for explosives, and it's supposed to sink with when, you know, the character hits the roof. And they missed it. So we threw her a second time in case it did, but you know, one car. Now you, no stunt.
No stunt woman for mine. Damn it.
How exactly was your, you had to stand, you were standing, and then they had the body behind you?
Yeah, there was the raft, and there was a hole cut into the raft, and I was standing straight up, and then leaning over, and then a fake back was put on me, so it looks like I'm lying down in the raft.
How long we were in the water, if you remember?
So she was blue, bluish. No, the truth is, no, really, but Judy, the truth is, that was an incredibly difficult thing to do, and we were very stupid about it. have to have these weapons, even though the weapons are prepared so they can be close to actors, they still could hurt someone. So I wanted a stunt guy who really knew how to handle that. And also, you know, he's used to being very specific about, a stunt person, as you know, used to being very specific about hitting marks and, you know, just exactly what he has to do. Now, there's been a lot of legend that, you know, paints this picture that he and I were in combat. Actually, we hardly ever talked. He might have talked to, you know, he was your protector, you know, cowboy protecting you. He never talked to me about that. He talked to me about feeling cold himself. You know, but he had a wetsuit on and you didn't. You know.
Well, I did have a wetsuit on from here down.
Yeah. When we had your casting of your, you know,
the
cold.
But it was
incredibly cold. It wasn't an option to not shoot. The company would not give us the day and not shoot. Very incredibly difficult thing. And it's interesting because for me, when I watch the film, like when I watch it with you guys now, it doesn't feel cold when you look at that. You know, it does not feel cold. You sell it completely. You don't get a sense of how miserable it was because the crew was bundled up and stuff. You know, when you're out there. But, you know, something like this is always about distraction. It's turning us all, audience and characters, into voyeurs. Tommy looking out the window, you know, Ted looking at the film. They're all voyeurs, even voyeurs of the gore as well, you know. So, and we, watching the films, become voyeurs. So it's all a matter of distraction. So that, you know, we're looking at that, or Axel is looking at the television, you know, the workout stuff on the television, cheesy stuff, and gets his head twisted around. It's about that kind of shell game where we're trying to throw your attention to something very, very base so that, you know, you can feel the impact of the hit harder. Sometimes we succeed at it, and sometimes I can see, you know, I feel we haven't succeeded. But that's really what it's about. And it's the same thing with the relationships. What I love about the cast that we had on this movie, more than other casts that I've had on other films, I felt the relationships developing. I cared about them. I cared about, you know, Sarah, and coming out finally, being impressed by your character, impressed by Sam, Judie, and changing her behavior, finding, falling in love, and of course then dying. I like Crispin and Camilla a lot. I mean, it was wonderful to see him finally triumph. Ted comes up with nothing because he's a man. Yes, he comes up with nothing. That's what happened. But the thing is, the only two who don't get anything out of it is Ted and the kid Tommy. Everybody else seems to luck out. Well, Trish. But I believe the relationships in the comic book context of a film like this. I felt that these people were getting to know each other and you cared about them a little bit, and that was special. And also, they all had very different characters, and that was special too. And the cast accomplished that for us, you know. So I think we're very lucky with that.
Lawrence, my theory is that Teddy is actually Gary from Last American Virgin, who was so devastated at the end. He's like, you know what? I'm moving out of this town. I'm gonna reinvent myself. I'm gonna be this, because you still don't get any in this one, and then you get killed. But your death scene, you actually get off kind of easy in this one. It's in the back, and then how did yours work?
I actually don't get off at all.
your death scene. How did think of the back?
It wasn't very hard. Yeah. I mean, the one thing that was interesting about that scene was, I think, is people asked, you know, did I actually get stoned, you know, while watching the film, and I did. Do you know that?
I didn't know it at the time. No. I thought you were just brilliant. I've come to a different opinion over the years.
I don't remember if I was actually stoned for that moment, but yeah, it was pretty easy. I mean, it was just a matter of walking up to the screen, and it was just technical with the blood and the knife. And
actually, we did it very simply in the end. There was a big plan about doing the casting of your head and how this was going to be Tom was really pushing for, you know, a very elaborate puncturing of, you know, your skull. And in the end, I just wanted to feel really what I was interested in. I came up with this with your dad. You know, I just imagined it, and I liked the slitting of the screen and the blood, you know, behind you, rather than, you know, showing the, you know, puncture or something, I guess. So it wasn't really a horrific, well, it's horrific in its idea, but it wasn't, you know, demonstrated specifically. And I think that was a good choice to do that. In a few cases, we didn't demonstrate their deaths, even with Tom's skill, we didn't demonstrate it specifically. As with some of the women, and of course, I didn't want to put a woman in a shower like everybody does, so I put this excessively pretty guy, Peter Martin, in the shower and let him get that pretty face smashed against the wall. So yeah, I kind of tried to turn that around, and actually the guys got the some of the worst deaths in this.
Your boyfriends in particular is quite painful to watch. You mentioned quickly the ending, but you guys were kind of locked in a room in a house in Malibu, something to kind of, because they moved up your release date, right? So you guys had a lot less time to finish the movie.
That was the worst. I've told this story before, so those of you who follow this stuff, you know, I don't want to bore you with it. But we had a very, very short release time between the end of shooting and the release of the film. And it's one of these things that, you know, you cannot screw up, because Paramount was going to book 1,600 theaters, which in those days was a phenomenal number. Now you have 700,000, you know, theaters. But in those days, 1,700 theaters was just an amazing booking for a film. And this film was going to start on that day no matter what. So we had only 5 weeks. So I brought some editors that worked with me before on other films, on the Prowl and other things before, and they put us in a house. The house was supposed to be in Malibu, they said. It wasn't, it was down the block in front of us. Like everything in Hollywood, you know, it's exaggerated. And we didn't leave. We stayed there, lived there, moved in and lived there, worked 24 hours a day, editing. So we had to, because of the time schedule, lock one reel at a time, one 10-minute reel at a time. Now, what that means is that we never see it together until you guys see it, until we all see it together. Because we have to lock a 10-minute reel, we send it out in that cradle sound, and that's that. We don't see it again. And then the next 10 minutes. So if you think the pacing is a little, you know, like wacky in the show, it shouldn't be surprising. We never could look at the whole film and say, hey, wait a second, let's move that faster, and let's slow that down. And it's just, we thought that was 10-minute way to tell that part of the story, and the next was the next 10 minutes. And in fact, we weren't even cutting completely in order, because we had three editing suites going at the same time, and I was like supervising all of it, because I had an editorial service before, so I knew my way around the cutting room. So we manufactured it in pieces, you know, and well, what you get is what you see. What you see is what you get. What you get is what you see.
We tend to like it. I think that's pretty good. Yeah. For all of you, did any of you bother keeping up with the rest of the series, or did you just kind of be like, eh, I'm good? Like, did you ever? No. Did any of the actors watch the previous three when you got hired? No. You missed out, man.
I had to study the previous three, of course, yeah. You know, and I also didn't want to do the recap at the beginning. We didn't edit it. That was something that, you know, actually Frank Mancuso Jr. supervised the cutting of that from the previous things. I didn't want to have that recap. You know, it always felt cheesy to me, and I wanted to start just with the death of Jason, because it's a movie about death, and it's a movie about Jason being dead. Now, you know, we can argue at maybe another time, another place, whether Jason's a zombie, you know, whether he's a dead thing walking. I mean, I kind of feel that he is sort of a dead thing walking. And I like to think he's a dead thing walking, because we made him run. And it was, you know, it was great. And also, I always have characters running to the wrong place. You know, they run upstairs instead of away. You know, this gives you guys a chance to be way smarter than the characters. They go down in the basement when they shouldn't.
So we have time for a couple questions from you guys out here. Yes, sir, right there.
Guys don't know is the skinny dipping scene. So you guys, I'm sure, are
set with all of us, and just seeing actually how hard you and Crispin really worked to come up with real creative ideas. And I think that also brings it to a different level this Friday the 13th. That's my feeling to you and Crispin.
Yeah, and that's correct. What Lawrence is saying is correct. We had the outline of that scene, and the truth is we couldn't really figure out how to make it work. Because we knew the following. There was a guy named Phil Scuderi. He's gone to the great screening in the sky, but the thing is that he was the owner of Friday the 13th of the series. He was an exhibitor, a theater owner in Boston. And he then licensed it to Paramount and all of the rest. We used to talk, that's how the script got really done. He would call me every night at 8 o'clock exactly and speak to me for one full hour, 8 to 9. And he had this idea of the scene. He said, you know, kids are now using computers. It was a very basic kind of conversation. He said, kids are using computers now a lot. I said, okay, yeah. And he said, we got to do something with a computer. So I said, okay, well, what do you got? And he said, and he had very specific things. And he also came up with the idea of calling Jimmy a dead fuck. So it was going to be a dead fuck, and there was going to be a computer, and somehow there was going to be dead fuck was going to come up on the computer. He didn't understand computers. He never had one. He never worked with one. He just knew that when computers were out there, and dead fuck was a cool idea. So we kind of had that, and they turned it into that scene. But the business of Ted calling, you know, Jimmy a dead fuck was his idea and was scripted. But how to make that computer thing work, I actually didn't have a clue how to make that computer thing work without a computer besides. So you guys did do that. And the structure that I just talked about is what came to you. That's what you worked with.
All right, we got time for one more. Way in the back, yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes. ScreamFest website.